Toenament Time.
Happy Toenament, everybody.
Tony won. Here we are. We got all of our picks. We did the draft. If you haven't seen the draft, it's on our Patreon. You can watch the whole thing, how we came to arrive at all of our picks. And I'm here with George. I'm here with Steve. I'm here with Nick. And we've all picked our four top songs. And we have a very special guest, Melinda Mixer, Joe Blevins himself. Welcome. You're going to be judging. You have a lot of pressure.
Yeah, this is a high pressure situation, but my ears are ready. My toes are ready. I feel judgmental. So I'm ready to do this.
Yep. And you, I think you're going to know most of these songs because you've seen Probably. A lot of the show. Yeah. But so for people that don't know some of your Melinda mixes, maybe we can play some of those right up top.
Well, okay, I have an exclusive that no one has seen.
Oh, really? A brand new one. Oh, yeah.
A brand new one. So this will be fun.
Okay, wait, have I seen this? I haven't seen this?
No. Oh, but this is... Sweet. This is from on Willie's Garage. We watched an episode of Alf recently where Willie was imitating Alf, and he goes, "I like anarchy." And I think we mused that would make a great punk rock song. In steps Joe Blevins, and he made this amazing music video to go along with the amazing mix.
More food. I haven't had a meal in half an hour. I finished my meal. I guess I'll watch TV while everybody else does the dishes.
You unlucky.
Rules, schmools. I hate rules. I like anarchy. How about we just break things?
Oh, is that it?
And a little tribute there to the god of chaos, Max Wright, Willie Tanner.
Right. I could hear your guys' reactions to it, but I couldn't actually hear the song myself. So
we've been having problems with that. So just, you know, if that happens again, just nod your head along like you're enjoying the song.
Well, I know what it sounds like because I just made it a few days ago, so I know every second of that stupid thing.
Hey, you watch your tongue about your own work there.
Let me play my favorite Joe Blevins song of all time. He took an IMG. I forgot what the number was, but we called it the rap family. The rap family. And
Ooba Dooba.
Ooba Dooba. Yeah. And it was a freestyle rap family. And then you added a beat to it. And it still pops into my head to this day. And it should actually be in the toe tapping tournament. But it got slighted. So here's that.
Going for a walk with Lottie dog. Mess with me will turn into a hawk.
I'm here. With my cousin I haven't seen for many years. I don't know how many years it's been, maybe 12 or more, but here I am.
Went to the park with the doggy-doos, and guess what they did? Doobie-doobie-doo.
Daisy Duty, that's her name. Going Duty is her claim to fame.
Masterful. So we're in good hands today. We are in good hands. Go ahead.
I just want to point out that song gave me the opportunity to sample a record that I've been wanting to sample for years. Which is called Bats in the Belfry by Napoleon XIV. They're coming to take me away, ha ha.
Yeah.
Guy. He did this whole album of like really trippy music, and that's on it. So people should check that out. So.
Yes, for sure. We'll promote other stuff. We'll promote your blog. We'll promote the book that Steve has behind him at the end of this. Let's jump into this tournament. We got a lot to cover here. Yes, this is high pressure. I'm actually kind of nervous because we're gonna tackle my side of the tournament, the right side here. We're gonna start up with the Joe League here, and I'm calling it just the Dr. Tammy side, just arbitrarily. So this is Dr. Tammy's side. Should we start off big? Start off with The Eyes Have It versus Red Hot. This is going to my number one was The Eyes Have It. Going up against George's number four, Red Hot, which I'm surprised Red Hot is number four. That seems like a number one draft pick, but.
Yeah, but no, I knew that it was sufficiently obscure that no one else would pick it. I knew I could say it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Smart play.
All right. So let's get started. I'll start off with The Eyes Have It since I'm number one. All right. You ready? The Eyes Have It.
Yep.
Now, this was a video that was where did we find this? I don't even, probably a thrift store. And it was for an eye makeup video. And there's a song that starts the whole thing off called The Eyes Have It, and it's so goddamn catchy. Here it is. My number one pick. Dictionary definition of a toe tapper. Yep, Donna Mills, that's who it was. Yep.
It was like Connie Selica, not Connie Selica, not Joan Van Ark.
It's all, they're all the same. Yeah.
Which one was she? Was she like Dallas or Dynasty? Or
she... I think she was Dynasty.
Yeah.
All right, there you go. There's my number one. What are your just initial thoughts?
My initial thoughts is that it takes me back to the 80s and like Flashdance and Footloose and that feel. I think maybe the song lyrically is a little lacking. I think they could expand on how the eyes have it or what the eyes actually have. But really to get people excited about eyes and Donna Mills, I can't think of a better song than that, really.
Yeah,
so
I couldn't agree with you more.
This tournament is probably starting like here, and then like the energy is just going to go down from there.
Well, you got to start off strong. Otherwise, you're going to lose people. Yeah. George, what do you got?
Well, I believe in 1986, the Calgary Flames, the Canadian hockey team. Is that correct?
Yep, from Alberta, yeah.
put together a classic song. I'm guessing not a single person involved with the team actually performed on it, but they certainly do try in the video. And it's a 3.5 minute song. I have an excerpt, of course. So this is Calgary Flames, Red Hot, or You Can't Touch a Flame When It's Red Hot.
Brett Hull is one of the guys.
Okay, I'll spare you the instrumental breakdown. But this song is the greatest song that's ever been written.
There's a very good chance that these two songs came out in the same year. The Eyes Have It and Red Hot. They're very similar style-wise. Yeah.
Raspy, yeah.
Also, was that... William H. Macy from Boogie Nights singing that. He has like that little Bill from Boogie Nights look to him.
Oh, yeah. With the Yosemite Sam.
The red mustache. Yeah, that's true.
McSorley.
Yeah,
that counts in its favor.
Was that McSorley?
I think so.
Because, my dad was a big hockey viewer and he would watch Hockey Night in Canada every week and was infamous. Like he was this guy. Sorley was a very appropriate name for that dude. So I can't imagine him singing and... So he was like the most violent dude.
And Brett Hull was in there too, right?
Yeah, briefly. Yeah. A fresh-faced Brett Hull. We had heard about that video, and we mentioned it on stage in Calgary one year, and then somebody had brought us the VHS, because I guess they're littered around Calgary thrift stores, because, everyone bought them at the time, and then off to the Goodwill. So we actually have the original VHS of that.
So what it was first, before... Joe decides on the winner here. Steve, why don't you give your opinion? Nick, you give your opinion. They're just opinions. They're not votes. And then Joe will decide. Okay. Steve, what do you think?
So for my opinion is definitely that The Eyes Have It is the clear front runner out of these two. While I think that the Calgary Flames was a great song and certainly inspirational, it didn't have me tapping the toes like The Eyes Have It did.
I'd agree with you more. Nick, thoughts?
Well, I kind of want to buck the trend of just repeating the same thing over and over again, which is what most jingles do. And I believe the way they get in your head is by repetition. I think that's been proven. So I almost think that's cheating in a way, the fact that it just repeats it over and over. Not cheating, but it's almost an unfair advantage. But I have to admit, the more toe-tapping song to me is The Eyes Have It.
Okay. All right, Joe. Wow, you got your work cut off right here. These are two very good songs starting off the tournament. So I don't envy your decision here.
One thing is just that was the mono mix. By the time that we hear it again in the next round, I will have a better
stereo version. Well, first, I have to admire the Calgary Flames for not doing the rap record, for not going the rap doing the bad rap, because like I've heard Get Metsmerized and, you know, Super Bowl Shuffle. Obviously, I live here in the Chicago
Let's Ram
area.
It. Yeah.
So yeah. I have to admire them for doing that. I think maybe they went a little too subtle and to come up with like actual, like that was like the, you know, more of a, like a pitchfork or, you know, kind of approved track. So that's one that they were going for the critics, I think, right, more than the audience. You know, they were going for like a classy song that the critics might actually like. Whereas The Eyes Have It has no pretensions at all. It is just like, we are going to sell this freaking catchphrase by repeating it over and over again. And so while you guys were talking about the merits of Red Hot, in my brain, I'm just going, the eyes have it, the eyes have it, the eyes have it. So I'm sorry, George. I know we're not going to hear the, if this, I hate to say this, but it's got to be Red Hot. And it's got to be Eyes Have It, rather.
Oh, you almost threw us for a loop.
I had a heart attack for a second.
It has to be the eyes have it. I'm sorry.
All right. Well, you gotta follow your heart.
Hey, don't worry about hurt feelings here, Joe. This is sports.
The number one going up against the number four. There's no surprises here. I think Las Vegas probably had The Eyes Have It as the winner on that one too. So
also no surprises that you burped while saying that. All just textbooks so far.
There are actually catchier songs called Red Hot, because there's a 50s song called, you know, My Gal Is Red Hot, Your Gal Is Doodly Squat.
Sure.
And so I was thinking of that song, because in our area at least, it was used for as the jingle for a store that sold uniforms, like work uniforms, like you had to buy your uniform. And they changed to My Uniform's Red Hot. And so I was thinking,
that's a spoof? Was that a spoof of that?
Yeah.
Squeeze three syllables where there was one. I think that's a great idea.
Instead of My Gal Is Red Hot, it's My Uniform's Red Hot. So I was thinking of that Red Hot. And I also thought when I was a kid that it was so crummy that you would have to buy your uniform for work. I just thought that was like, that's what the adult world is. Like, you have to buy an outfit to wear to work. Like,
so your workplace could make some dough off you. Yeah,
exactly. So, but there was a store that sold uniforms in the mall. So, and they use that as their jingle, Red Hot. So
let's move on down to the George.
Well, Joe, before we move on, I just want to correct myself so I don't have to eat any Batman cereal. It was Lanny McDonald, not Marty McSorley, who was in that video.
Lanny McDonald. I was thinking, like McSorley's not going to sing any songs, man. McSorley was like a maniac. He was like a tough guy.
I feel like that incorrect fact threw off
the whole thing.
That was part of my plan. All right.
Okay. So what are we? All right. So now we're going into the George bracket down here, and we're going to kick things off with his number one pick, Rem Lazar's Higher.
Does this need a setup? Everybody knows Rem Lazar, the kids' video starring Jack Mulcahy, the guest, special guest on episode 100 of VCR Party. We're going to hear his signature song, Higher.
From within your mind, no one else can find the life that you inspire. From another,
it's a good one.
Not from outer space, from someplace even higher. Rem Lazar.
Rem Lazar.
I can run, I can jump, I can dance and sing. Believe in yourself and do anything.
Believe in yourself and do anything.
From within your mind. No.
All right, I think that's enough. But that song is awesome.
That's strong as hell. Joe, initial thoughts just on Rem Lazar?
That is just such a pure earworm. It's just so classic. It just reminds me of like music when you're on hold and you don't even mind being on hold because the music is so soothing to you.
Yeah.
And you think like every so often.
Keep me on hold for a few minutes more because I just want to hear this Ramlazarian.
I've had that before where I have talked to the person who eventually picked up the phone. I was like, what was the hold music? And they're like,
can you
I
put
no
me
idea.
Back on hold?
Yeah.
Yes. I also like that he points out that he can run and jump. Like the kids can run and jump. Like I can, you know.
Yeah, I don't need a magical creature made out of a mop and a mannequin to do that for me.
But isn't that the point that we innately have? I mean, yes. Unless you have an injury.
Quixotic vision. It's all in us.
Okay, so my pick here, this is my number four pick. I called this my dark horse. This is an Otis song. And if you remember last time's tournament, Otis won. My Otis pick, Springer Mountain Chicken, won the entire tournament. And so for my dark horse, I went with another Otis song. I thought maybe I could recapture the magic. And this song, it's called Dearborn Brand Meats. And what it's most famous for is the scene where the woman delivers the bacon to her family and she has oranges, we call it bacon oranges, a plate of bacon oranges. So I think the bacon oranges, and I think the song, I think you're gonna like this, Joe. Here it is, Otis's Dearborn Brand Meats.
Great taste is just the beginning with Dearborn Brand. Another beautiful day in our hometown. Friends and neighbors gathered around. Great taste is just the beginning. Wonderful meals, all is fine. Served up beautifully every time. Great taste is just the beginning with Dearborn Brand.
So I just a quick update. There is an update about that commercial that somebody had sent me, and I'll let you know about that update if it moves on to the next round.
Okay.
Oh God.
Well, oh God.
I think you're overestimating how much anybody cares about that update. But, go ahead.
So, first, let's Steve. What are your thoughts between these two? Between Remlazar's Hire and Dearborn Brand Meats.
I've got to tell you, I'm glad I'm not in Joe's position. Or this is the closest I've seen one. I went back and forth. I thought I was going to go with Remlazar's Hire, but right now in the moment, I'm changing it only because of the bacon oranges. They were neck and neck, but the bacon oranges is, I'm going to go with Dearborn Brand.
You know, there's that other moment in there too. I forgot to point out that they were watching a commercial for Dearborn Meats while they were sitting around the table eating Dearborn Meats.
Yeah.
I thought you were going to go with where the grandfather gets fed the sausage.
Well, let's hear what the vegan thinks.
Well, also, yeah, you're right. There was that part where the grandfather got fed some sausage.
I think it's a clear winner. I don't think it's close at all. Remlazar's Hire. I think Dearborn Meats. I already forgot how the jingle went. You know,
great
I can't remember.
Listen. It goes like this. It goes. Great taste is just the beginning with Dearborn Meats.
I've never heard you singing that around the office, but I've heard you singing Hire a lot, whether you know it or not. So
yeah,
I'm going.
You
back
inspired me, Joe.
The more toe tapping of the jingles.
Oh, Joe, this is tough. This is not another number one versus number four. What do you think? Who's your pick? And
oh my gosh!
First, like, what? Both, and let's hear.
Well, first off, they're similar in a way in that they're both more soothing. These are more sort of soothing earworm type of songs that you just feel good while you're listening to them, and it makes you feel good about Remlazar, or it makes you feel good about Dearborn Meats. And as a Michigander, I used to live in Michigan. I should be like really sympathetic to this Dearborn Meats song because I don't know how far Flint is from Dearborn, but it can't be that far because we would get Dearborn commercials and stuff. But it's clearly Remlazar. It's clearly like Remlazar's Hire by a mile.
Okay.
Because I'm thinking, you know, Remlazar. And I was trying to think of what song it reminded me of. And while you were talking about the merits of Dearborn Meats, I realized what song it reminded me of, which was a song called Telephone Line by ELO, the Electric Light Orchestra.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
And
sure.
So I was thinking there's a part of that where I could, and I was already thinking like, oh, I could mash up a Telephone Line with Remlazar. I was thinking,
interesting
already,
to see how the Blevins brain works. This
I'm
is
already thinking like ahead to a mashup of those two songs. So it's clearly Remlazar.
Okay. I respect
and
the
also,
hell out of that. I respect the hell out of it, and no complaint here, although, I mean, it was my dark horse, and I thought I had a chance.
I hate to shoot a dark horse, but I have to do it.
Put him down.
Also, the Remlazar episode, I think, was probably my favorite episode that you've ever done of
that was a fun one. And you know what? Next week I start on Jack Mulcahy's softball league. So we got a first practice. Cool. Yeah. Yeah.
So oh, nice.
We've been in touch. Yeah. So
that dude is exactly what you'd hope a guy like that would be like. You'd hope that the guy from
I can't wait to tell him that like Rem Lazar's hire has gone on to round two.
If that wins, we could have him cut down the VHS basketball net after he wins the
yes.
whole thing.
Yes. So, all right. Fine. All right. Here's our third round. We're going back up to the Joe League. And we are going to have Lindau Man start things off here. Lindau Man was sent to me by somebody. I forgot who it was. But what was it, like 2,000 years ago, Lindau Man died, and he died in a bog and apparently got ran over by a steamroller. And then he sat in this bog for 2,000 years, and then some school children found him. I assume.
Yeah, 1984. Yeah.
The school children found him, right?
Yep. They were out digging.
Similar to the plot from Rem Lazar.
They were out digging and.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
They were running back to life.
They're running. They were jumping. They brought him back to life. And so it was a huge phenomenon in England. And the school group, they wrote a song about it. And then they made t-shirts eventually. And I would love to plug our t-shirts at some point for this. But here's the song that elementary school kids, the primary school kids made. It's called Lindau Man, We Want You Back.
Oh, cool. You get behind the scenes in the studio.
Exactly. An angel.
A terrible drum beat.
That shirt for sale. store.soundfootagefest.com. I can't believe I got this in the second round.
We don't need no education.
Oh, there you go, Joe.
We don't need no thought control.
All right, I think we all got the gist of it.
Yeah. Have you guys heard of the Langley Schools Music Project?
Yes. Yeah.
You know that
I thought of that, yes.
That's exactly. What it sounds like to me.
It sounds exactly mm-hmm. like that. It's a whole Haunting. Album of Lindau Man's, really, but yeah. like covers of, yeah.
I think the Langley School covered Lindau Man. Did they? Yeah.
Yeah. all right, George. Initial thoughts, Joe?
Okay, the other thing is...
I guess you did with Langley. Yeah,
it sounds a little bit like that, but it also sounds... There was this British novelty song called Mr. Blobby that went to number one in England, and it became infamous as the worst song in British history to go to number one, and it sounds so much like Lindau Man.
What year did that song?
That was like the 90s. Like, Mr. Blobby was a character from some prank video show where a guy would pretend to be a children's show character, and he would prank people by, like, he looks kind of like a Pink Grimace, and so that he got a huge novelty hit where these kids are singing about Blobby, Mr. Blobby, and
are you guys writing this down? We should be showing this at some point.
Yeah, Mr. Blobby. Yeah. Okay. You gotta Mr. Blobby is a whole rabbit hole to jump down, because you can find the Mr. Blobby pranks, but you can also find the Mr. Blobby song. And I was thinking about that when I was listening to Lindau Man. So Cinderella's gonna
I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing though.
Yeah, so it's kind of good and bad, but
okay,
I'll hear what Cinderella has to say.
George?
Well, in the early 80s, Philadelphia metal band Cinderella couldn't get airplay on MTV, so they came up with the idea of doing a jingle for a local chili dog stand, and then having the owner buy time on MTV. So then they could, and that is how they actually got a record deal. And here is their song, which is, well, I think it's incredible. Ooh. It's tough.
That's wrong.
Hold on, let me find it. There it is. The lead singer force feeding a child a chicken.
Yeah, I noticed that too. I was like, that kid does not look happy with that.
It's like waterboarding with a chili dog.
Chili boarding, yeah.
Well,
by the way, here's Mr. Blobby. That's
Mr. Blobby. That's him.
Oh, yes. I've seen Mr. Blobby before. Okay,
Mr. Blobby.
My nightmares.
Yeah,
it's a nightmare thing. But he was supposed to be bad. He's supposed to be like a bad kids show character that they pranked people with. Like, oh, you're going to be appearing with the famous kids show character, Mr. Blobby, and then like the adults wouldn't know who that is because they're not kids. So,
right.
That was always the prank. But I got to say. I got to admit a prejudice here.
Before we go into that, I think we have to. Steve has to give his opinion first.
Okay,
go ahead. Nick will give his opinion. Steve, what do you think between Lindau Man and Cinderella's Pat's Chili Dogs?
I mean, Lindau Man, poor guy got run over by a steamroller. The least we can do is let him go on in this tournament.
Okay.
Pat's dogs.
Wow. All right.
It's the repetition. It's direct. Yeah. Pat's dogs.
I respect the hell out of the song. I think it's, but you know, Lindau Man it's a classic. So, Joe.
Here's where I have to admit a prejudice. When I was a kid in the 1980s, I was super into hair metal. So I actually had Cinderella's album. Because I still to this day think that Somebody Save Me is a straight up banger of a song.
Oh, no.
It's just, I'm sorry, Lindau Man. There's nothing that you could do to persuade me.
Because
it's got to be Cinderella for me.
Pat's Chili Dogs moves on.
It also sounds like hot blooded.
Yes.
Wow.
Interesting. Now, but you know what? Lindau Man might be back again because he lost in the first round. So for next year's tournament. He might be back.
Yeah, he has a chance to be back.
He might be found in 2,000 years.
Exactly. We want you back again.
Well, and I feel like we've just been playing a lot of Lindau Man in the last like couple months, and I think we need to hear it anymore. I think it's time to hear Pat's Chili Dogs a bunch more times. So, all right, last one for this tournament: Jaleel White's "Contents Under Pressure" going up against "Pee-Pee My Bed." George.
Right. I think this is an early 90s kids health and abstinence video. You know, this show is huge for abstinence, except, you know, for Nick.
Sexual man. Yeah, he's a highly sexual man.
Can't do it. Couldn't do it.
Contents under pressure, I just might blow. Contents under pressure, I just might blow. Contents under pressure, I just might blow. I'm not ready for the wild thing. And what do I see? Drops and drops of sweat pouring down on me. The pressure. People school think that's kind of screwy because I passed up on the school door knob. Something about rejection, it really turns her on. And Judy is like hawking me, she won't leave me alone. My buddy say,
yo, Julian, we gon' bust it out, dude.
Cause making it with Judy gives you clown. But Jay's not a jerk, even though she is a teaser. I'm not about to treat the female like a skeezer. If I step to her and do her, they will all stop the teaser.
I wasn't expecting him to use the word skeezer.
Contents under pressure, I just might blow. Contents under pressure, I just might blow. Contents under pressure, I just might blow.
Genuinely good song.
Oh, he had to have it on cue cards. That, I don't know. That seems like a little bit of a ripoff there. Come on. But because I was
Jaleel should have memorized.
Like, Jaleel's got bars, but maybe he doesn't. You know, like, if he had to. I wish he had shown me the cue card thing.
Oh, the cue cards might have ruined it for you. Okay, well, this is interesting.
It did a little.
But wasn't that an early 90s, like, video little, thing of like the
well,
behind
like
the scenes
NX...
crosscut with in black and white.
Okay,
the...
I was thinking like the NXS video where they're like imitating
or
the Bob,
or the Bob
Dylan
thing,
thing. Where then NXS did. I knew it first from NXS and then knew Bob Dylan because I
and also the Weird Al video for UHF parody.
Oh yeah, he does that later too, and then he blows up the jukebox or something.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. All right, Jaleel White's "Contents Under Pressure" is going up against Pee Pee. Which is a song by the Kelly family, which is this weird family from, I think they're from the United States, but they would tour all around Europe singing these songs, and they were just kind of like this weird family band, and everybody grew out their hair long, and they kind of dressed like Little House on the Prairie, and they wrote a song about bedwetting, and they performed it in like an auditorium for a lot of people, miraculously, and this song has just been in my head constantly. This is my number two pick, I think. I think Lindoman was my number three, actually. No. This is my number three. PP is my number three pick. Yeah. PP is my number three. Okay. Here it is. PP by the Kelly Family.
His mic work isn't great.
He's a child.
Yeah, but he's performing. This is...
But that's part of the charm. Positive message here, too. Think about his mic work now.
That's good. It's great now. It just took him a while to warm up.
He's a kid. Cut him some slack.
Okay. Well, don't perform if you don't know how to hold a mic. That's my...
Okay. Did you get it, or did you need more?
You know, was that song going anywhere? Was there like a twist? Like it turns into something else?
Well, let's see. Hold on a second. Well, no, let's hold on.
I think I'm seeing a trend in those picks. Repetition.
How come she gets all the reaction shots? Who is that in the audience?
Everybody else is sleeping.
Clearly in Europe somewhere.
I think I might be ruining
it. Joe's blowing his brains out. I think his choice is made.
Simply stop.
Okay.
You know, I became fascinated with... Okay, go ahead.
No, I mean it's a good message, and I think that it's good for kids to hear that another child has had problems peeing in the bed, and so like, but he's like, tonight is not the night. I'm not going to do it. So, Steve, let's just go down. Steve, what do you think about this head to head? Jaleel White's Contents Under Pressure versus Pee Pee My Bed.
I'm going to go with Jaleel. I feel like both had good messages, but ultimately, cue cards are not. The better song was Jaleel.
Nick?
Going pee-pee. I'm going pee-pee.
With a song choice.
Yeah.
Despite the mic work, you were able to look past.
I was able to look past it. Okay. And there's just so many weird things. The Svengali father, the fact that he squandered their millions, the fact that they lived a hobo lifestyle in Europe. I mean, it's a fascinating story, and it all culminates in I Ain't Gonna Pee-Pee My Bed.
And we really don't have any other songs
for Nick
like
is important.
Wait, what?
Biography is important for Nick. None of that is inherent in the song.
No.
Okay. Yeah.
For me. Everybody brings their own opinion to the toe-tapping tournament. Right. The toe-tapping tournament means different things to different people. But what does it mean to you, Joe?
What it means to me is that when I first heard the PP song way before VCR Party Live, it was something that was just going around on the internet. And I started looking into the history of the family, and then I forgot every last bit of it. Nick just brought up some of it, but I was like, who is the Father Time guy on the stage? Who is the old man in the robe? And so I found out about that, and I thought, wow, this is really crazy. Musically, though, this is a music tournament. Mm-hmm. Like, who created the best song musically?
Right.
That you could tap your toe to.
You could tap your toe to, and we're not even supposed to go by the visuals. Right, no. Isn't that part of the rules? We're supposed to just
sure. So, let's say that. Sure, yeah.
Well, I mean, visuals are important,
but
because like MTV, you're not going to completely discount those.
I'm going to hate myself for this. I'm going Jaleel White. I'm
sorry.
Wow. I'm going Jaleel White because it's because Jaleel's rapping is better than I expected. His rapping was way better than I expected it to be. Even though right now I'm thinking pee-pee my bed tonight, you know, you said it was a positive message, but what about, you know, I might pee-pee my bed tonight, but that's okay because I don't feel shame about it. You know, that should be a message, you know.
But you should feel shame about it.
Okay, maybe. I don't, you know, I don't know.
That would be the wrong message. Yeah.
Peeing your bed is like a serial killer trait, right? So yeah. You don't want to like shame those kids further.
Right. Well,
but also don't want to breed serial killers.
No, but
so
you want to be,
if they're not peeing like, in their bed, then they're not going to be serial killers.
Well, I read Sarah Silverman's book. Sarah Silverman wrote a whole book called The Bedwetter.
Yeah.
She wrote a whole book about how she had wet the bed a lot as a kid and maybe still did as an adult. So,
real quick, do you want to see what the pee-pee in my bed looks like now? This is Angelo. Yes. Most people have like come out against their father and said he was awful and controlling. Here's Angelo Kelly, not peeing his bed anymore.
Or maybe he is. I don't know.
Yeah, I think he doth protest too much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
lives in Spain and is still a singer.
Okay.
I'm getting serial killer vibes off of that picture. Unfortunately, he looks like a guy who would pick up hitchhikers and then like they're never seen again. So I don't know. That guy looks sinister to me. I don't know.
All right. But, well, let's recap here. We got to wrap up here, but okay. The eyes have it. So I'm happy that my number one moved on because I feel strong that. But that's all I have left. After that, George won with Pat's Chili Dogs, beat out Lindau Man in an upset. Was that an upset? No, that wasn't an upset.
Yeah,
that was.
It feels like an upset.
No, because. Lindau Man was my number two. Yeah, number three beat number two. Rem Lazar's edged out Dearborn Brand Meats. Do you have any regrets on that, Joe? Like going with the Rem Lazar's higher?
No, Rem Lazar is the one I feel best about.
Okay.
And then, good. You weren't baited into that. Great.
Okay.
No, because I genuinely love that song. And
I mean, you weren't baited into Joe's giving you a guilt trip about that.
Oh, no.
Thank you.
The one I probably feel worse about is Pee-Pee, My Bad.
That's what I was going to say is I feel like tomorrow morning you're going to wake up and you're going to be like, what have I done?
What am I doing? Like
wake up in a pool of urine and you're going to be like,
exactly. So
the sign is here.
But you said it was your number two pick or number three pick.
Pee-Pee My Bed was number three. Yeah. So
it should have been your number one pick because it's a urine song.
Oh, but you know what I think ruined it was the fact that you had already heard it a bunch on the internet before that.
I'd already, it was still new to me.
Yeah, it was still new to me.
I was sick of it by then. So,
and I liked the title too, and I was excited to see the title in the draft. So yeah. I got caught up in
it. We'll see how the fun picks pan out.
Well, I gotta say, I'm sorry. I'm bad about, I wouldn't have picked like, I had no tolerance for Super Duper Pooper. I just couldn't with that song.
That was my number two pick. That was last year.
Number two is correct.
It's got to be, yeah.
I would probably like subliminally for like deep-seated Freudian reasons, like vote against the pee-pee and poo-poo songs. So, yeah.
All right. Well, we got our picks. George, you really came out ahead. You got three. I got one. And we will go.
Round two next week.
Yeah.
Joe, thanks for being a guest judge. Keep the Melinda Mixes coming. They are all amazing. We love them.
And should we
plug anything for you?
Yeah, talk about your blog.
Oh, God, I have so much stuff to plug.
Yeah.
And thank you, Steve, for having my book in the background. It's about a guy. It's called Dad Made Dirty Movies. It's available wherever books exist. I got all my stuff to plug right here.
There we go.
And holding all that stuff up. My blog is at d2writes.blogspot.com. I'm on Twitter at @Joe_A_Blevins. My book is called Dad Made Dirty Movies. It's about a guy who escaped from communist Bulgaria and then made softcore porn films in the 60s and 70s with Ed Wood. It's a really crazy story. And we spent years and years working on it. And I got to say, writing books is for suckers, man. That is a ton of work and you make no money off of it. And I forgot that I forgot to plug my weekly podcast. I have a weekly podcast called These Days Are Ours, a Happy Days podcast. It's basically like Willie's Garage, but for Happy Days. It's at thesedaysareours.libsyn.com. That's LIBSYN.com. These Days Are Ours. And basically,
are you a connoisseur? Like, or you're a
no,
aficionado of.
I'm the George of the show. Basically, a Happy Days super fan contacted me and said, do you want to do a Happy Days podcast? And I was like, why not? And then I realized that there's 255 episodes of Happy Days, and it's going to take forever to do them. And we're into season six.
You guys should start a support group. The two of you should like start a support group for the sidekicks of shows you don't really care about.
So I don't really, I use it to research other topics. Like I find like all the references in the episode. And the craziest thing I got to point out about Happy Days, most of this show takes place in the Cunninghams' house in their living room.
Yes.
If you can picture their living room, they have a bookcase on one end of the living room. That bookcase is full of gay porn.
No way.
Absolutely. There's like a big close-up of it. One of the books is called like Summer of Sodom. And
is that like an inside joke for the crew? Like they're like,
that's what I think it is. That, okay. The crew put a bunch of gay porn and it's in every single episode. So now, wow, I see every time I look at the bookcase, like, oh, Summer of Sodom, that's Confessions of a Male Madam.
Probably in HD. They didn't expect them to be like super crisp on, you know, happy days indeed.
Wow. If Elf had stuff like that, I might watch the Elf's Garage show.
Oh, it does. You should watch it.
They sneak dirty jokes into Elf. They sneak.
Absolutely.
Like,
sweet. Yeah. Nice work. I would say just a couple missteps in there. But other than that, I thought you did very well, very thought out. I felt like we were in good hands with you. So
thank you, Joe Blevins. We'll see you next week on round two of the Toe Tapping Toenament.
That's it.
May!